So just a disclaimer to start, I'm not at 100% tonight. I herniated a disc in my back last night, so I'm kind of a comma. And I may need to sit halfway through, so hopefully won't get to that point, but if I do, it's not because I'm tired or bored. So I was actually so excited to give this presentation tonight, I decided to take the painkillers and push on through. So thanks, Rohan, for having me. Just a little personal background. I'm a principal at Edison. I've been here for about 5 years. Prior to Edison, I had a couple of operating roles, startups, as well as other high-tech firms. I was actually mostly a developer, focused on database development and payments back when neither of those were particularly interesting sectors. And given what's going on there now, I may have pushed eject a little too soon. But so in any case, Edison, we're an expansion stage venture capital firm. I guess you could call us a leading venture capital investor. We've been around for about 25 years. We have about $850 million under management, investing out of our seventh fund, which is a pretty new fund for us. It closed last year, about a $250 million fund. We were named after Thomas Edison, not Edison, New Jersey, as many people think. And our founder is actually the largest private collector of Thomas Edison memorabilia, I think, in the world, most of which is now in our office. So we think it actually used to live in his house, and his wife got sick of him and kicked it out, so now we get all the stuff. But it's great. If you ever get to go, it's a great office, neat history. There's 11 investment professionals, 9 specialists. Main office is in Lawrenceville, New Jersey. We have a couple other offices, including our new westward expansion into Ohio. We do focus on a couple of sectors, fintech, healthcare IT, interactive marketing and e-commerce, and what we call Enterprise 2.0, which is sort of a cop-out because it covers a wide variety of technologies not covered in the first three. As I said, we do about $850 million on management. I guess we're up to 183 prior investments now, about 50 active portfolio companies, and 125 exits with 23 IPOs. So that's pretty long track record. Focus for our firm is software and internet, as well as sort of IT. We sort of do everything but clean tech, biotech, anything that's a business that's enabled by technology. About 80% of what we do is enterprise and B2B oriented. About 20 is consumer, although that mix is actually changing to some degree. We're probably more like 70-30 at this point. We do like recurring revenue models. We can find them. And obviously, we're looking for teams that have domain and operating expertise, or if not, can find people who do and hire them. What's a little interesting for us, so we're generally looking for businesses that are north of $4 million in revenue, growing quickly, but we're typically the first institutional capital into a company. So those two things don't seem to match up, but we actually have found a lot of businesses where entrepreneurs have found ways to bootstrap up to that level, and whether it's customer-funded development, whether it's generous angels, single, rich, angel, female, women?
I meant to say just independently wealthy.
Independently wealthy, okay, yeah. So that's, in our mind, capital efficiency is one of the main determinants of success of a business, and the best indicator of that long-term is how capital efficient you are up front. And again, typically our checks are $5 to $10 million up front, and we'll reserve generally about 50% to follow on. Generally, companies we invest in have proven out a couple of things. They've proven out technology risk. They've proven out market risk, and to some degree found product market fit. And what they're really looking to do is sort of step on the gas. So fund sales and marketing, go after channels, go international. Those are the sorts of things that our team has a lot of experience with, and we feel we can be helpful, not just from a capital perspective, but from an operating perspective as well. The team in Edison, it's sort of an interesting mix of backgrounds. So you have plenty of guys like me that come from operating roles, but you also have folks that come out of finance and investment banking. And so you get sort of exposure to both of those sets of skills. And so it's great sort of for growing a business, but also for selling a business. I mentioned the sectors before. This, I think the slide just sort of shows it's a pretty broad exposure within each sector. I think we are, if not the largest, one of the top three healthcare IT investors on the East Coast, and I believe we are actually the most active fintech investor in the East Coast. Just a couple of slides on kind of our value add. So one thing that we do is our Edison Director Network, And that is a group of about 160 execs that are either current or former CEOs or top management teams of our companies or other industry luminaries that we've recruited to join. Generally, these are folks who have been through the movie before, know how it ends, and can help you get there. And hopefully have been in your industry and usually local, so they'll take you out for a beer. The other point of that is companies we invest in that are successful, we generally try and recruit the management teams to come back and serve another board, so we have a nice cross-pollination on our portfolio companies. Just a little bit more about some of the things that that we do. So we put on events for our portfolio companies. Generally, they're oriented along functional lines. So we'll do a CTO event, a sales and marketing event. We do a CEO summit every year, which is out in Atlantic City. And we give the CEOs $100 each to gamble with. And given the results last year, we should probably take a stake in some of the winnings for this coming year. That's always fun. And so we also do some industry specialty oriented events. We did a fintech roundtable this year. Over the summer, we did a interactive marketing and e-commerce event. We actually had the banker from Morgan Stanley, who was lead on Facebook, give the keynote, and there were some uncomfortable questions afterwards. It was kind of fun. So Rohan wanted me to speak a little bit about areas we're interested in. I'll talk to the sectors I'm involved with, which is interactive marketing and e-commerce. These are a couple of our portfolio companies in the space that are doing well. By the way, Neat Receipts, local company based down on Market Street. For those of you who are looking for jobs, looking to hire tech talent, it's a high double-digit revenue business growing about 80% year over year. So if you're interested, come talk to me afterwards. In terms of opportunities, so some of the areas we're looking at are mobile advertising, which is service space that's gotten a lot of buzz, but there's actually quite a lot of underlying technology that's not there yet. So the infrastructure is not developed. It's tough to do a lot of the tracking and optimization that you can do on display or traditional sort of search advertising. So we see a lot of opportunity there. Next generation CRM, it's sort of a catch-all for a lot of what's going on in terms of interactive marketing. So we think things like inbound marketing and content marketing are driving really exciting opportunities. And as you see this sort of explosion of distribution channels, it becomes incredibly complex to try and manage that. And so especially for companies that are outside of, say the Fortune 500, to have a marketing manager try and manage all the things that are going on within a marketing program is difficult. And we think there's a lot of interesting solutions being built there. And then e-commerce infrastructure. So within e-commerce, what we've sort of seen is marketing spend has been a little bit bifurcated in that people have paid a lot of money to acquire traffic, acquire customers, and you're at the point where you're getting sort of decreasing marginal returns for each marketing dollar spent. And so the issue is marketing budgets exist, but how can you apply them effectively? And one of the ways you can do that is by affecting conversion rate. And so we actually think there's a lot of opportunity around optimization, around analytics, around some of the loyalty marketing programs that you can integrate into e-commerce. And so that's certainly an area of focus for us. What's not on here, and what I think is a little bit interesting about Edison, is we are a thematic investor, but we're also sort of market opportunistic. And one of the ways we look at the world, it's almost contrarian, right? So we try and say, what's an area that was hot? People have moved away from it. They've figured it's dead, it's killed, and there's likely no more opportunity. That's sort of low-hanging fruit. We actually think that's a really interesting place to look. So a good example here, actually within next generation CRM, is the content management space, right? CMS systems have been around forever. They haven't evolved particularly well. And it's difficult for these folks to integrate with social channels or with mobile channels. And you get a lot of ugly one-off custom integration. So actually, if you look within CMS systems, there's a revolution that's going on. It's quiet still, but it's an emerging opportunity. So just another example there. And that's it for slides. I wanted to just talk about two things that I think make Edison somewhat unique. So the first is it's a little different than other VCs' perspective. We like niche markets, right? So a lot of VCs will tell you need to be going after a multi-billion-dollar market to have a shot at a really premium outcome. We disagree. We think in smaller markets, if you can back a potential market leader, and you pick your spots, you can actually get really premium returns. And you can do it in a space where it's going to be less competitive. It'll require less capital because there's less sort of marketing buzz you have to overcome. So, you know, when a VC tells you you don't have a $5 billion market, don't waste your time. Don't believe them. And the other piece that goes along with that is capital efficiency. So we actually will only back companies that we think can get to escape velocity at less than $20 million invested. So the reason we think that way is if you look at the universe of venture-backed companies and what they exited successfully at, it's typically less than $100 million. There are a few sort of outliers that are in the $1.5 billion range, but we sort of think we live in a world of, you know, $80 to $100 million exits is a win. So if you start raising $30, $40, $50 million, it's hard to see a way that everyone gets what they need to get out of an investment, both from your VCs as well as from your management team, for people to be happy. So we think there's an opportunity, especially with some of the new sort of cloud-based technologies out there, to scale businesses at less than that number. And that also plays into sort of the niche market opportunities. If you go after a $5 billion market and you have 30 competitors, everyone is raising a ton of money and spending a lot of money in marketing, you got to go big to win. And, you know, first place will do great, second place will do okay, and everyone else will flame out. So that's not a place that we think is healthy as a market dynamic. So that's it in terms of prepared remarks. My back's starting to give out on me, so I'm sorry that I'm rushing. But I'm happy to take questions from the audience either now or later, and feel free to ask away. So the question was, what do I think are things that will resonate with me in an investor pitch? I typically like to see people lead with team and have a team that has relevant experience in a particular industry. So from an investor perspective, you know, when we first hear a pitch, we're looking for a way to say no quickly. How can I disqualify this thing and just move on fast, right? And so if I see a company come and pitch me and they go through the business model, they go through the market, they go through, you know, all the other pieces, and then they get to the end and they tell me about their experience, I have to wait till the end to figure out if they know what they're talking about. If up front you tell me you've spent 15 years in this industry and you know these folks and you've recruited folks who have been in the industry as well, that's a great way to sort of shortcut that, and I'm interested at that point. I'll believe what you say for the rest of the pitch. I'm not sitting waiting to see if you actually know what you're talking about, because I'm probably not going to know that, you know, whatever your particular industry is, that well. So that's the first piece. I'd say the second, we are a little bit later stage. We look at, you know, financials and things like that. But I would say even your early stage investors are going to want to understand the economics in your business. So, you know, when I hear folks tell me, we have a hockey stick, that's basically it. You know, and they don't talk about margins. They don't talk about, cost of goods. They don't talk about gross margin. It tends to set up warning bells that you haven't done enough research on your opportunity to understand what kind of businesses can be. You know, at the end of the day, when you get to scale, are you going to be a 5% EBITDA margin business? Are you going to be a 50% EBITDA margin business? So those are things, when you can cover those and nail those questions, that's generally really engaging and exciting for us. So I guess another good one to talk about is Octagon, which was based out in the Burbs and actually recently acquired by Accenture. And that was in the clinical trials management space. And that's a good one. Verilog, which is also in the healthcare IT space, which is also based right outside of Philly. So those are the three most recent ones we've done. I've been encouraged by the startup environment here and all the interesting, you know, companies we're seeing coming out. So hoping to do a couple more in the near future. Yeah. That's a good question. So the question was, with the restrictions, the criteria that we have in terms of a little bit later stage, regional focus, to some degree industry focus, how do we find enough companies to fill our pipeline to do, you know, 25 to 30 investments a fund that we do? So we're pretty active, and part of the reason, you know, we're involved with Philly Tech Meetup, is we're pretty active with early stage companies. We think it's valuable to build relationships over time. And actually, it's an interesting data point. We did a study on our successful portfolio companies to try and figure out what could we have known ahead of time that would have helped tell us this is going to be a successful company, this is going to be a problem company, right? The biggest determinant for us was how long we knew the entrepreneur or management team ahead of time. And the break point was 18 to 24 months. So if we'd been talking to a company for 2 years prior to investing, we had a pretty good sense that this was going to be a good investment. So we spent a lot of time talking with companies that are very early, getting to know you, you get to know us. Hopefully we can help along the way. We do sort of biz dev stuff. We'll make introductions and those sorts of things. It's a big investment on our part, but we think it's worth it. Good question.